Today, let us learn what is called Urizon's lemma, right, in normal spaces. The lemma statement is this, very, very simple. It says that a topological space is said to be normal. A topological space X tau is normal if and only if given two disjoint closed sets, right, F1 and F2, so two disjoint closed sets have been given, F1 and F2, and an interval 0, 1. This interval could be AB also, any interval AB. There exists a continuous function F from X to 0, 1, such that the first closed set will go to 0, the second closed set will go to 1. Fine, this is the Urizon's lemma. So there is if and only if here, so we have to prove both necessity and sufficiency. First, we shall prove sufficiency. So sufficiency, what is given sufficiency, we'll write down. Given for any two disjoint closed sets, F1 and F2, two closed sets which are disjoint, for any two disjoint closed sets, there exists a continuous function, okay, F from where to where? X to the interval 0, 1, X to the interval 0, 1, such that the first closed set will go to 0 and the second closed set, F of F2, will go to 1. This happens for any two disjoint closed sets in a topological space. And to prove that, TPT means to prove that that topological space X tau is normal. X tau is normal. Now, a topological space is normal if two disjoint closed sets can be separated by two disjoint open sets, right? So let me take two disjoint closed sets. So let F1 and F2 be two disjoint what sets? Closed sets. Of course, in X. And at the end, we want two disjoint open sets separating these two, F1 and F2. Right? Okay. But what they have given? They have given for any two disjoint closed sets, there exists a continuous function. This part is happening. So this implies there exists a continuous function. We'll call the function as F from where to where? X to 0, 1. Right? Such that the closed set, first closed set will go to 0 and the second closed set will go to 1. That is given. Okay? Now, let us consider usual topology. So consider, remember, I want what? I want two disjoint closed sets, right? In X, separating F1 and F2. Okay, let us consider usual topology, of course, on the real numbers R. And here I have 0, 1, the closed interval is a subset of R, right? So 0, 1, that is here, we'll mark on the real line. This is our real line. So 0 and 1. Fine, we'll mark on the real line. Now, let us take the intervals. I'm taking two intervals. Two intervals are like this. Two intervals. I'm marking gain here. So here I 0 and here is 1, say. This is our real line. Okay. Now I'll divide this closed interval 0, 1 to, you know, 3 parts. We'll cut into 3 parts, 3 equal parts. Fine, this is our closed interval. Fine, then this is our 1 by 3. This is our 2 by 3. Fine, then consider including 0 and excluding 1 by 3. The interval like this. Can I write this as an open interval intersection 0, 1? So I want 0, that is only this part I want. This part I want. So I can write down this as minus 1 by 3 plus 1 by 3 intersection 0, 1. So minus 1 by 3 somewhere here. This is minus 1 by 3. This open interval. Okay. Intersection, the closed interval 0, 1 is nothing but this interval. And this minus 1 by 3 and 1 by 3 is an open interval. Right. And is an open set. Is open in R with respect to the usual topology. It belongs to tau. So you have tau element intersection Y. Okay, tau element intersection is set here. So therefore, this set, this interval is open in 0, 1. Now similarly, I'll take another interval. Another interval is like this, excluding 2 by 3, and I include 1. Can I write this as an open interval intersection 0, 1? Open interval. So open interval, I'll take it as 2 by 3. And the next one here, that is 4 by 3. This is 4 by 3, this point. So this will be the common points. So 2 by 3 and 4 by 3. And this 2 by 3 and 4 by 3. 2 by 3, 4 by 3 is an open interval. So therefore is open in R with respect to the usual topology R. So I have got this interval as a tau element intersection Y. A tau element intersection Y. So therefore these two, 0, 1 by 3 and 2 by 3 not included, 1 included. These two are open sets where open in the set Y. Y is this 0, 1. That is, they belong to tau star with respect to the relative topology, right? So they are open in 0, 1. Are they disjoint? And they are disjoint. So I got two disjoint open sets in 0, 1. Right? Now, and what about F inverses of these? So next step. F inverse of the open set 0, 1 by 3 and F inverse of 2 by 3, 1. These two are open in X. Why they are open in X? Because our F is continuous. Our F is continuous. And the inverse of an open set is open. Therefore, these two are open in X. So I got two open sets in X, right? We'll call this as point one. We got two open sets where in X. Are they disjoint? So F inverse of, I'm checking the disjointness, intersection F inverse of 2 by 3, 1. This is nothing but F inverse of 0, 1 by 3, intersection 2 by 3, 1, right? We can put one more bracket here. And that is nothing but F inverse of, these two are disjoint, so null set is null. So they are disjoint. So we got two disjoint open sets where in X. Do they separate, F1 and F2? Let us check. Okay, third point. What is f of since f of f1 is nothing but singleton 0, we have this. So this implies f1 will be contained in F inverse of singleton 0, and this will be contained in F inverse of 0 1 by 3, right? So therefore F1 is contained in the first open set, that is this. And since F of F2 is equal to 1, so therefore F2 is contained in F inverse 1, following guys, and that is contained in F inverse 2 by 3 comma 1. So we got F2 is contained in F inverse 2 by 3 1. This is open interval there. Sorry, this is closed, correct. That is F inverse 2 by 3 open and 1 is closed. This is wrong here. Right? F2 is contained in this. So by 1, 2, 3. By 1, 2, and 3. 3. So we got two disjoint open sets in X separating F1 and F2. So therefore, X tau is normal. Therefore, X tau is normal. Hence, we have proved sufficiency. Sufficiency is proved. Very, very simple. Now, we shall go to prove the necessary part of this. Right? Yes. Necessary of this. So, what is necessary given? Let us see. So, given necessary. So, given necessary. Given. So what is necessary given? Given X tau is normal, the topological space X tau is dash normal. To prove that, given any two disjoint closed sets, given any two disjoint closed sets. Okay, in X, of course, in X, we have to prove that there exists what mapping? Continuous function or mapping. Mapping F from where to where? X to the interval 0, 1. X to the interval 0, 1, such that the first closed set will go to 0 and the second closed set will go to 1. Okay, this is what we have to prove. Okay, so now we'll do it in different steps. We'll make into small steps and we'll do it. Okay, so now. Okay, so let us take two disjoint closed sets. So let F1 and F2 be two disjoint closed sets. We have taken two disjoint closed sets, right? Of course, in X, remember, we want a continuous function from X to 0, 1, such that the first closed set should go to 0 and the second closed set should go to 1. Right? Okay. Now, since they are disjoint, F2 is null. So, F1 will be completely in F2 complement. And F2 complement, we'll call it as G1. And what is F2 complement? Is open. Why it is open? Because F2 is closed. F2 is closed. Therefore, its complement, F2 complement, that is, we have called it as G1. G1 is open. So we have a closed set. And we have an open set. The closed set is contained in the open set. And our X tau is normal. By the characteristic property of normality, there exists another open set. There exists another open set. We'll call that open set as G0, such that F1 is contained in G0 bar that is contained in the open set G1. Open set D, G1. Let us call this as equation 1. Okay, remember this. The equation is very, very important. This equation we are going to use at the end. Okay, yes. So now, let us consider the set of rational numbers. We know that since the set of rational numbers, is it countable or uncountable? The set of rationals is countable. The full set of rationals is countable. And the set of all, therefore, the set of all rationals in 0, 1 is also countable. Okay. And we'll call the set of all rationals in 0, 1 as this, and let it be. Rn n equal to 0 to infinity, fine, where r naught, n equal to 0 means r naught is 0 and r1, the last one, is 1, right? The remaining are in between rationals, fine. And let us denote G naught. I've got in the equation 1 G naught, right? So I'm just rewriting this as G R naught. 0 is R naught. No, I'm just replacing 0 by R naught. And there's also G1 in equation 1. So G1 is nothing but G R1. Okay, then. Equation 1 is also giving me. I'll take this part of the equation 1. I'll just mark it. This one will be used little later at the end. So this is used now. So we have equation 1 is giving me this. Now I'll just replace naught by G naught by this, G1 by GR1 in equation 1. So 1 is giving me now G R naught bar is contained in G R1. Okay, what is G R naught? G R naught bar is definitely closed set. Any set bar is closed, and this is an open set. An open set. So we have a closed set contained in an open set. Whenever a closed set contained in an open set in X, and X is normal. So by the characteristic property of the normality, what is happening? There is exists another open set in between these two that I am writing in the next step. So there exists by normality, there exists another open set. We'll call that open set G R2, such that the closed set, that is G R naught bar, that is contained in GR2, okay, and that is contained in GR2 bar, that is contained in the open set GR1, fine. So where is R0? R2 now, and say we'll take this R2 in between R0 and R1. We'll take R2 in between these two, fine. Now again, this is a closed set. This is an open set. This is closed set, and this is an open set. So again, by normality, what is happening? By normality, again there exists another open set, GR3, an open set. I can take in between these two or these two. So now I'll choose R3. If R3 is in between R0 and R2, such that R0 less than R3 less than R2, I'll take this GR3 in between these two. And GR0 is contained in GR3 that is contained in GR3 bar that is contained in GR2. Okay, I can take in between these also. So if R3 is such that R2 less than R3 less than R1, then I'll take in between these two. That is GR2 is contained in GR3 that is contained in GR3 bar that is contained in GR1. Right, I have, you know, I can choose in between this or in between this. Fine. So I can go on doing this now. Again, this is a closed set contained in an open set. Closed set contained in an open set. Again, there exists one more open set. We'll call that open set as GR4 and etc. It goes on. Right. So we get a collection of, so we are getting a collection of all open sets. We are getting collection of all open sets. How are the open sets? The open sets are, what is our R? R is a rational. R is a rational. And the suffixes, if P less than Q, if P less than Q, now watch here, you can just see here. R3 less than R1. So I have GR3 bar is contained in GR1. So whenever P is less than Q, we have the corresponding open set GP. The bar of that is contained in GQ. Okay, so such a collection of open sets exists in X tau. Okay, and by convention, we'll take GR equal to null set for R less than 0 and GR equal to X for R greater than 1, such that we can take all the open sets now, all the open sets, even null set and the whole set and all GRs. And how are our GRs? Whenever P is less than Q, I rewrite that. So whenever P is less than Q, remember the lesser is this. So therefore, GP bar is contained in GQ. This is very, very important. And this is happening for the collection of open sets GRs. Fine. This is our step one. Necessary step one is completed. Now we shall go to step two. Remember, we need a function. Fine. We need a function. What is the function? I want a function which is, continuous, and the first closed set should go to 0 and the second closed set should go to 1. That is our aim. We want a continuous function from x to the interval 0, 1. Okay, yes. Now we shall go to step 2. We shall go to step 2. Step 2 is this. Let us call this as step 2. We are doing necessary. In the necessary, first step is over. In the first step, we have got collection of all open sets. Okay, GRs with the property that whenever P less than Q, we have GP whole bar is contained in GQ, right? Now in the step two, slowly I'm coming to function now. Take any point belonging to X, define Q of X like this. Q of X is equal to R, suffixes R, X belonging to GR. Take any element belonging to X. So definitely it will belong to some open sets. Remember, we have called open sets GRs. So definitely it will belong to some GRs. Take the suffixes R. Fine, this is our Q of X. And clearly, Q of X is bounded below by 0. Bounded below by 0 because our GR is null set for R less than 0. And null set doesn't contain any element here. So if at all it contains, definitely it will be greater than 0. So it will be bounded below by 0. Bounded below by 0. Now define F. Define F from where to where? We'll take X from x to r. We are taking f from x to r, the real numbers here. We'll define by f of x is equal to infimum of q of x. Right? That is, f of x is nothing but infimum of, I'm writing q of x, r x belonging to gr. And clearly this will be a real number, rational number, and infimum could be a real number, so it will belong to, so clearly f of x will belong to r for all x belonging to capital X. So therefore our f is well defined. Okay, and if x belongs to gr, now watch, gr is contained in gr bar, so definitely x will belong to gr bar. Okay, and this will imply x will belong to gs for all s greater than r, as this is less, no, so therefore gr bar is contained in gs. So whenever x belongs to gr bar, that is here, this will definitely belong to gs, because we have gr bar is contained in gs because of s is greater than s. Fine. So therefore q of x contains what? Q of x, definitely, you know, see, our x is belonging to gr, so definitely r will belong to q of x. So q of x contains r, of course, and all rationals greater than this r, and rationals what, greater than r. So therefore our f of x, which we have defined as infimum of q of x, will be definitely less than or equal to r. R will belong to q of x, and all other rationals will be greater than r. So therefore infimum could be equal to r or maybe less than r, right? So therefore we have got what? F of x is lesser than or equal to r. So when is this? This is when, if x will belong to gr. So whenever x belongs to gr, we have got f of x lesser than or equal to r. Right? Now, similarly, if x doesn't belong to gr, then what? It will imply that x will not belong to gs for all s less than r. So our s is less than r, no? So what is our gs bar? Is contained in gr, right? And this will rewrite it. Gs will be contained in gs bar, and gs bar is contained in gr because of this. So whenever x doesn't belong to g of s, that is this, definitely it will not belong to this gr. Right? So whenever x doesn't belong to gr, definitely for all s lesser than r, our x will not belong. Right? Okay, that means what? This implies, what is our q of x? Q of x doesn't contain, whenever, see, it doesn't belong to, our x doesn't belong to g of r, no, so definitely this r will not belong to q of x. So therefore, r also will not be there in q of x, and all the rationals less than r also will not be there. So it doesn't contain any rational less than r. So what is our f of x now? So therefore, f of x is equal to infimum of q of x, okay, will definitely be greater than or equal to r. because our q of x doesn't contain r, definitely doesn't contain r, and also it doesn't contain any rational less than r, any rational less than r. So therefore our infimum of q of x will be definitely greater than or equal to r. So therefore f of x will be greater than or equal to r. When this is happening, when x doesn't belong to gr. We'll put a box for this. We have to remember this. Okay, yes. So we got two things now. Whenever it belongs, I have lesser than or equal to. Whenever it doesn't belong, I have greater than or equal to r. Right? Okay. Now, since any element we are taking from x only, and by convention, what we have called this x as, our gr is nothing but x for r greater than 1. Greater than 1. Correct? So, x, small element belongs to capital X. Capital X is nothing but this. No? So, x will belong to gr. R is greater than 1. Right? For all r greater than 1. So, whenever x belongs, what is our f of x? Whenever x belongs to some open set, this is nothing but lesser than or equal to r. All r greater than 1. So, therefore, clearly, our f of x will be lesser than or equal to 1. Equal to 1. Right? Similarly, the other point. Since null set doesn't contain any point, right? And we have called gr is equal to null set for r less than 0. So, therefore, x doesn't belong to gr. R is less than 0. I can say for all r less than 0. Right? Whenever it doesn't belong, what is our f of x? F of x is doesn't belong to, so greater than or equal to r for all r less than 0. So therefore, our function f of x has to be greater than or equal to 0. We'll put a box for this. So we have two boxes here. So we have got what? We'll combine both now, this and this together. So we have got what? 0 lesser than or equal to f of x lesser than or equal to 1. This is what we have got. So therefore, what is this function now? Function which we had taken from x to r, full real numbers. It's not full real numbers. It is x to only between the intervals 0 and 1. So closed interval 0, 1. So we got a function, right? We got a function from where to where? From x to 0, 1. Right? X to 0, 1. So that is our step 2. Now we shall go to step 3. So we got a function anyway. So now we'll prove f of f1 is 0 and f of f2 is singleton 1. Okay? So now next, step 3. Step 3, we shall prove f of f1 is singleton 0 and f of f2 is singleton 1. We shall prove this. And very easy to prove. Okay. So take any element in, let us take belonging to f1. And by 1, f1 is contained in g0. By 1. Remember the first part of 1. Right. So, we got x belonging to g naught, right? Whenever it belongs, therefore, what is the image f of x? F of x will be lesser than or equal to the rational 0, right? So, this implies I can have maybe less than 0 or f of x may be equal to 0. And it belongs to some open set, so I cannot have less than 0. So therefore, f of x has to be equal to 0 because f of x cannot be less than 0. Right? F of x. So therefore, f of x is 0 for all x coming from f1. So therefore, we have proved f of f1 is singleton 0. Now we shall prove f of f2 is singleton 1. Now, take any element belonging to f2. Right? So definitely our x will not belong to f